Hello and welcome and a very, very good morning. It's 8 a.m. in New Delhi. I'm Satya Srigandham on WION Breakfast and we have
Sejal Pandey again today. Hello everyone, good morning.
And good morning. So before anything, here's a heads up on what we have lined up for you on the show today. On WION Breakfast this morning, we bring you a story from Afghanistan where women have taken lead to support the family.
In our world segment, we will talk about the return of postmen on the streets of Kinshasa.
This week on WION Stretch, we have Zubin Atre. Follow him for his unique yoga mantras.
And after yoga, my favorite, we'll also have something for all you food lovers. Stay tuned to find out what's on our Quick Bites.
So those are the stories that's going to come up shortly. But Sejal, tell me. One, we look color coordinated today.
Totally.
It almost looks like we checked up with each other.
Yes, and I love how it was not planned at all.
And you look very cheerful. Tell us, what keeps you so happy today?
What keeps us so happy today is lightheartedness. So yesterday, after I made the confession on television.
Oh, yes, she made the confession on national television. Well
done,
girl.
And my mom made it a point to watch it. And even though she couldn't catch the live version, she asked me for the recorded one, our web version that we upload on our website. And I showed it to her, she watched it, and she was like, so this is something, how much else have you been hiding from
me? I know, she gave you the look, huh?
Yeah, so I realized that speak the truth no matter how it is. And that's what's making me lighthearted today. And I think it's a really good thought to, you know, base your beliefs on.
I totally agree. And yes, lightheartedness it is. And that's what makes Sejal's day today. Yes, WION Breakfast, everyone is lighthearted.
Yes.
And that's what we look forward to throughout the day. Well, moving on to the first story, the central government of India recently notified Adoption Regulation 2017, framed by Central Adoption Resource Authority, which became effective on Monday. Adoption in India has for over the past year been a matter of much debate. Let's take a look.
In August 2015, the Indian government issued revised guidelines for adoption to simplify the process and bring in greater transparency. The Central Adoption Resource Authority, CARA, became the nodal agency to coordinate the entire adoption process.
Everything is being done online. The parents don't have to run around to the various agencies. The system is leveraging technology to have a better matching wherein the children in any location, in any SA, can be referred or get matched to a parent anywhere across the world.
CARA's revised guidelines took the entire process online. As per the rules, prospective parents undergo a vetting process. Details of three children are then shared with them. If they decide to adopt, the legal process begins. If not, they are pushed to the bottom of the wait list. However, these new guidelines have come in for heavy criticism. In fact, some have even slammed the process as e-commerce for baby shopping. Adoption in India has always been a long-drawn process. The new regulations try to cut this down and also tackle the issue of illegal sale of babies. But is it a thoroughly planned move or are they superficial changes? This is Sri Sen, New Delhi, WION.
Well, that should certainly make the adoption process a little more
simpler
in the country. And I am sure that's going to bring a lot of joy to Indian homes.
Absolutely.
And outside. About adoption, you know, one often wonders, in fact, I've heard so many conversations about people adopting young children. On one hand, it's almost looked upon as something noble one is doing.
Yes.
You know, there are lots of children, but
don't have parents,
don't have
deprived
homes.
Of homes and exactly. Parents love, yeah.
That's right. On another hand, you know, there's a different school of thought. Mm-hmm. It is nothing to do with any nobility of
yes.
thought. You know,
yes.
It is something that we do for ourselves. we love children, so which is why we want children, so we adopt children.
Yes.
You know, there's really nothing called nobility, and so these two parallel streams of thought on
like,
the subject.
See, I think it's about love, if you look at it.
Totally,
love,
right?
Love is almost like the forgotten cure, you know. So it, as long as it makes you happy, you're in love with something, whether it's kids or books or anything else, it's you should do it.
Yeah,
there's
it's
nothing
like spreading
noble
love,
or
spreading cheer.
Bad about it.
That's right. Well then, so much for mother's love, huh?
Yes, absolutely. I'm totally up for adoption.
me too. Well then, moving on to the next story, which is in fact about woman being the head of the family, mm-hmm. at least being the breadwinner of the family. And the story comes from the mountainous central province of Bamiyan, one of Afghanistan's least developed but most liberal regions. Beekeeping complements its only other commercial crop, potatoes, and gives rural women the chance to become entrepreneurs. Let's take a look.
Fatima is busy earning a living. This mother of seven works with her husband and one of her sons producing honey. It's unusual for women and men to work together in rural areas of Afghanistan. But here, she is the boss.
I am very happy. My husband, my son, and I keep busy with this. My husband sells the equipment of beekeeping, and my son helps me to carry the heavy equipment and do what I can't manage.
I support her 100%. I solve whatever problems she faces.
As part of an NGO-led initiative, women from different villages in Bamiyan province have been trained on how to keep honeybees. According to official records, there are 400 registered beekeepers in Bamiyan, and half of them women. Together, they produce an average of 14 tons of honey each year.
First, my mom started beekeeping, but when she passed away, I took over. After I finished school, I didn't study further, so I could take care of the honeybees.
Said Fredun inherited this job from his wife.
An organization trained my wife and I learned from her. Now I'm handling the whole thing. The income of this is very good. One beehive benefits us more than the income from a sheep.
Beekeeping has offered these farmers a chance to diversify. While for women here, it's perhaps a step towards a more equal future.
What a lovely story over there.
What a lovely story. Women empowerment.
Women empowerment. So the man here inherits from the woman.
Yes. So I was so glad to see that. And the woman hasn't studied beyond school. She's just studied till school and she's still the breadwinner of the family.
And this is happening in
Afghanistan.
Oh my
yes,
God,
that's
more
super
power.
Super progressive.
Super progressive, more power to
yes.
the women there. Well,
on that note, let's slip into a short break. We'll be right back on WION Breakfast. Please don't go anywhere. Welcome back. You're watching WION Breakfast with me, Sejal Pandey, and the lovely Satya Shri Gandham. So, Satya, I made a confession yesterday. Why don't you make a confession today since you didn't yesterday?
Okay, I have several confessions to make. I don't know which one to start from, but
I'll tell you where to start from, actually. Start with a confession where you didn't get caught. You did something and you didn't get caught.
Oh, that's most of the times. Thank God for that. Thank God for that, right? Okay, let's start with this. My grandparents would know this. When I was a kid, I used to steal coins from my grandfather's coat. He used to have these, you know, small little change yeah. lying in his coat. I used to simply pick that up, go to school, you know, spend that money in eating toffees and chocolates. I never got caught.
I also used to do that, but I have a really funny incident that I remember from this. My younger brother, Even he used to steal coins from my parents, and you know, coins lying around on the dining table in coat pockets.
Yeah,
and
we want our toffees, you know.
Yeah.
We want our candy.
And one day he managed to steal coins worth ₹100.
Your brother is better than I am. It was at least worth it. I used to steal ₹1 coins.
But glad you never got caught, because if you get caught, then the next story is about that. So let's go to South America, where in a Uruguayan jail there are challenges happening. There are jail inmates over there, and in the country's traditional prison system, it allows jailmates to roam free during the day, encourages them to take up activities that help them reform. Let's take a look at this story.
The Afro-inspired beats of candombe music can be found on any street corner in Uruguay. Except these men are not out and about. They're all in jail. But in this prison, inmates spend little time behind bars. Instead, they're encouraged to work and even set up their own businesses or develop their creative side.
For me, this jail is, well, it's the closest thing to the outside world, right? In all jails, you're boxed in with bars, locks, police, knives, death, and lots of attacks. That's what you see in other places. But now I'm here, and I feel like I'm in a private neighborhood, as if I were outside.
This is like being outside. You're deprived of your freedom, but they let you show that you don't want to go out and be a criminal again.
A former detention center for women under the Uruguayan dictatorship, Punta del Rieles now serves as a blueprint as the country works to reform its prison system, which was deemed appalling in a 2009 UN report that unveiled large-scale human rights violations. This jail aims to recreate outside society, with most businesses on site owned by the inmates themselves, who hire other prisoners as their employees. They can either send their earnings to their families or exchange the money for coupons to buy goods inside the jail. The director, Luis Parodi, treating inmates as entrepreneurs rather than criminals is key.
We do believe that people are shaped by their own circumstances. That's something we strongly believe. Therefore, if the circumstances change, the person should change.
However, this is still a prison. Incidents with knives happen routinely, and an inmate recently escaped, only to be arrested later. But for some, like former gang leader Hilbert Ayrala, this place has opened up possibilities. With his cousin, he decided to set up a bakery inside the prison once they had been released.
The only possibilities I saw were here. I know that I couldn't launch a business like this one outside.
Against all odds, for these two former convicts, the prison has become a place to establish a new business and life for themselves, free from the confines of bars.
You're right, Sejal. I mean, if you do ever get caught, well, then make your time worthwhile. Like setting up a bakery. I think that's a wonderful thing to do. We've often showed stories on the breakfast show where prison mates across the world, including our Tihar jail, so much effort goes into their reformation and also just making entrepreneurs out of them, as the story says. It's about setting up a bakery.
Yes, and like we heard the guy in the bite saying that, you know, as circumstances change, the person also changes. So probably it's a really good thing for the way these guys are bringing up reformation for these guys.
I agree. So as they say, make the time count while you're doing time.
Absolutely.
On that note, we go to the next story, where if you remember, Sejal, one long time ago, we used to send postcards to each other. Yes. We used to write letters to each other.
We had I didn't have a pen friend, but I remember my mom telling me she had pen friends. She used to write to people she didn't know.
That's right.
Yes.
Well then, the world of letter writing, as you know, has gone through a sea change ever since. But then, after 30 years of turmoil for the postal service in the Democratic Republic of Congo, letter carriers clad in smart canary yellow shirts have finally returned to the streets of the capital.
The postmen and women of Kinshasa have once again taken to the city on foot, on bicycles and even mopeds to deliver letters and parcels. Let's take a look.
Waiting on the postman can be tedious. But here in Kinshasa, residents have managed to get by without a reliable postal system for 30 years. Some people here have never received a letter at all.
I've heard my parents talk about it since I was a baby, but I've never received a letter. This is a first.
Trust in the postal service eroded in previous decades as letters and packages were pilfered by postal workers. The workers themselves worked without pay and would only come to the sorting office to see which items were worth stealing.
There were inconsistencies at work. Often packages did not arrive, or letters went missing without a trace, and so customers didn't trust us.
The return to service was only possible after a deal was struck in which employees gave up their claims for more than 18 months' worth of back pay, instead settling for monthly salaries of several hundred dollars. Congo's postal service is dependent on state funds that come from fees charged to telecoms operators for use of an undersea fibre optic cable. To secure growth, the postal service is hoping to sign deals with DR Congo's water and electricity companies.
We have restarted the machine, the delivery routes, the new agreements with carriers. We have renovated post offices everywhere. Even if the building is not yet prepared, the postman is already ready to take part in this new adventure.
Despite significant progress, the postal service is, for the time being, only able to handle posts between overseas destinations and Kinshasa, meaning those outside the capital still have to rely on friends and family for delivering their mail.
Well, that was Kinshasa and how these guys are resorting back to writing letters to each other. For years, kids haven't received letters over there, but now finally they are. And we're so glad about that because for years we haven't written letters ourselves. We resort to emails and WhatsApp and messages.
I know.
When was the last time you wrote a letter, Satya?
Well, I cannot even remember. I remember receiving letters. I was really bad at writing letters. but this was quite some time. But it's really interesting to see how technology in some places has completely taken over the art of letter writing.
Yes, absolutely. So much so that recently I came across this post from a friend of mine who's a travel blogger. She was visiting Iceland and a few of her plans fell apart because it was really cold and it had snowed. So she decided to one day sit in a local cafe there and write postcards to all her friends across the globe. She has friends across the globe because she travels so much.
Nice.
And she wrote these postcards and she went to find a post office or a letterbox
and
she couldn't
find one.
So she walked into a supermarket and there was a 13-year-old boy there and she asked him, do you know where a post box, the nearest post box or post office is? And he said, I don't think I've ever seen one in this country. And then she talked about how this art is dying completely, you know, this culture of letter writing.
I know, receiving really long letters from my cousins, from my friends once upon a time. I have to confess, I was really bad at writing letters at that time. I used to write to me people, but do not expect me to write back. I was really bad at that time. But we're talking about, I don't know, decades ago.
Yes, absolutely.
And before the advent of the emails.
Yes.
Yeah.
Advent of the messenger, actually. Emails and messenger, both.
Well,
emails, yes, you still had to like put in an effort to write an email, but messenger is so instant that you don't even feel the need to write an email
anymore.
That is
something I still haven't gotten used to. Email I can still handle, I can still write long emails. Yeah, my boss is not going to like any of those emails, that's a different story. But I can still write long emails and even letters now. I mean, I've gotten back to writing now. I use fountain pens more than ball pens. So I enjoy writing now. Just generally writing, the feeling of writing.
I agree
totally
with you completely.
Enjoy.
Even I've taken to it very recently. I realized I was getting too used to typing on the computer. So I was like, now I'm going to start writing my thoughts on paper and then I'll put them onto a computer.
Well, for now, we're very happy for those wonderful people out there who are now managing to correspond with each other through letters thanks to these canary-colored T-shirt-bearing mopeds.
Carriers,
right?
Yes,
well, so we asked around a lot of people as to when they wrote their last letter.
Last letter.
And this is what they had to say. Take a look.
probably written less than 10 letters physically in my life. The last one was a fake for an April Fool's event. I wrote it to some woman.
I've never written a letter to anyone in my life.
The last time I wrote a letter was 15 years ago.
Last time I wrote a letter, it was a couple of days back to my best friend on her birthday. Personalized notes are always the best way to convey messages, I think.
So the last time I wrote a letter was this year itself. I sent a letter to my mom because it was her birthday. And we do this a lot in our family and as well as in my friend circle.
Basically, as far as you would ask me about like writing a letter to someone, I would say, I don't know. How many letters I've written for the past, like, the last time I've written a letter to someone, because the technology has come to such an extent that, you know, you never really pay much concern or you don't give much concern to writing letters to someone.
Because I wrote a letter to my husband only last month. Even though he stays with me, I love writing letters to him, and, you know, it just shows a little ways of appreciation, yeah.
Okay, I can't resist it. I have to sing that song that we used to sing as we were kids. I sent a letter to my father, all the way I lost it. Someone came and picked it up and put it in my pocket. On that note, we'll take a short break. But stay tuned as Sejal and I will pick up the papers after the break to read between the lines. Until then, you're still watching WION Breakfast. Come right back after the break.
Welcome back. You're watching WION Breakfast with me, Sejal Pandey, and Satya Shri Gandham. Before we went for a break, we told you about how letters were reviving, and in some places letters were dying. But now we're going to take you to the newspapers. But before we get to the newspapers, we will be reporting this morning about the headlines that are making news at this hour. Let's take a look.
More than 50 people killed as Nigerian military mistakenly bombs a refugee camp near the border with Cameroon.
US President Barack Obama reduced the sentence of transgender soldier Chelsea Manning, who was imprisoned for leaking classified documents to WikiLeaks.
D-Day for Bollywood actor Salman Khan, caught in Jodhpur, set to deliver a verdict against him in the Arms Act case. If convicted, he faces up to 7 years in jail.
And possible ISI hand behind last year's train accident near Kanpur that killed over 150 people, says the Bihar police. Three criminals have been arrested for planting bombs on tracks. Reveal links with a Nepalese contact.
Singur-like trouble for Mamata Banerjee. One person dead after violent protests at Bhangar in Bengal against acquisition of land for a power project. Those were the headlines making news at this hour. Now, before we pick up the newspapers to see what they have for us today, yesterday Sejal talked about a 19-year-old's story about her dilemma and her angst about the color of the skin playing such an important role in one's life.
Yes.
So we went around talking to people about what they thought about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you know, it's very, very interesting to know what other people think about it, because we can always have strong opinion about
yes.
things. So we sent out some of our friends to find out what people think about it, and here is what they had to say. Take a look.
Skin tone is not really there. It doesn't really matter if your the person you love is darker or fairer. It doesn't really matter.
I think I honestly think it comes naturally to people to judge people by the color of their skin. I don't know why and how it comes naturally, but honestly, I don't think it's right, because it might be good for the first impression, and when you first see a person, then that might, you know, get you the first attraction. But then ultimately, it's all about the personality.
So I think, as I said, there are two different questions. One is whether skin tone matters or not, and the other question is whether skin tone should matter or not. So whether it matters or not, I think we had a conversation that statistically speaking, I think it matters to a lot of people. But whether it should matter or not, I don't know.
If you're choosing a partner, you would not come up with, you would definitely love her of what she is, and you know, if you get to know her, you would definitely not judge her on the basis of her skin tone, because that's not what it really comes to.
As for relevance of skin tone, I'm not a shallow person, so it really doesn't matter to me.
So mixed reactions there, huh?
Yes, but I'm certainly with the ones who don't care about the skin tone.
I know, that you're so least in the priority of things. Well, we sent out a poll yesterday asking people if they would really consider skin tone to be a parameter when they're selecting their life partner. Well, we will bring you the results of the poll as and when we are able to get the final survey done. But for now, we will pick up the papers and Sejal and I will be reading between the lines. So Sejal, you've been looking at the DNA and I know you have a few stories. Let's start with yours.
Yes, and beautifully enough, I found both my stories on the same page. I just couldn't get my eyes off this part of the newspaper. The first one is about these IIT students who who've developed an app for the speech impaired. And these speech impaired people or people with cerebral palsy, autism, Down syndrome, or even brain injury can use this app to communicate with each other. And they can switch between English and Hindi. And this is obviously, since it's English and Hindi, it's mostly for the local audiences. But since
that's wonderful.
Since there is English, it can be used by other audiences as well. And there are about 8,200 inbuilt sentences already, so they don't even have to type much. And they get suggestions on, you know, how they want to construct their sentence, how they want to show it to each other.
That's awesome.
I think it's beautiful that people, and especially I remember IIT had also worked on an app for the vision impaired, how if for them to be able to take public transport for themselves. And now they've come up with this. So it's beautiful that people are working to help someone who's, not as privileged.
That's right.
Come up to speed to be able to use the same things as we use. And I think that's a beautiful thought and a beautiful action that's been taken on it.
I totally agree. It can't get better than that. I think it's really nice how technology can finally, make its way into those parts of our lives where we really need it the most.
Actually,
and yes,
absolutely.
When it comes to reading and writing,
absolutely.
I'm sure it's a huge leap in the lives of people who are not blessed with the eyesight. Now, talking about apps, I'm looking at the Mint. Mm-hmm. And I have an article by Shweta Taneja. Shweta Taneja helps people like me who travel a lot. And this is all about apps too. It's called Speak the Language of the Country You're Traveling To with these apps and devices.
Wow, that is such a relief.
Isn't it? Now, if only I'd read this article about like 3 weeks ago, I could have totally used these apps. Now, she lists out a whole bunch of them, and you know, you being the technology producer, you may be able to have a thing or two to say about it. So here's a list of all of these. Waygo, heading to China, Korea, or Japan, and want an app to read the signboards and menu.
Well, I've heard a lot of people talk about that, how it's so difficult when you travel to countries like China. There's no English translation and it's so difficult to find places out.
And the script is pictorial script.
Yes.
It's not even the regular script that you and I are used to. It's just beautiful pictorial script.
Right. At least in India, we see signboards with English letters on
That's
it,
right.
you know, even
That's
though
right.
the pronunciations belong to Hindi,
yes.
but they're still written in the English language. So people coming from abroad, they can read and at least find out where they want to go.
That's right. Way to go. Waygo is the way to go.
Way to go.
Right. There's another one called iTranslate Voice. Mm-hmm. Again, I remember going to Japan one time and people are lovely there. Oh,
yes.
My God. The only problem is that Before you even come to the problem, mm-hmm. I have to tell you that I did not ever know a word of Japanese. Mm-hmm. There's no way I could have spoken to any Japanese. Thanks to the dumb charades that we played in our schools and colleges, complete hand motions completely,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Now, that was a time when I would sit around with a few people and I would open up Google Translate on my phone and I would type something in English, translate to Japanese, and I would show it to them. Look, this is what I wrote. So for people like me, I translate voice. I don't always have to type it. I translate voice 3 translates conversation between two people using smartphones. So if you're speaking to someone in Spain, you hear English and the other person hears you speak Spanish. How cool is that?
Absolutely.
And then there is Sethi. Sethi is talking to your iOS devices and hear what you've said in a different language. Say hi. It's called Say Hi. Is designed for instant communication. Imagine somebody speaking in Spanish and you actually understand in your native language. How cool is that? Never Papago. Sorry, it's called Naver Papago Translate. Heading to South Korea, arm yourself with Papago, an app made in Korea that specializes in translation between English, Korean, simplified Chinese, and Japanese. I need it.
Absolutely. I think I need all of them, and so do you, Satya.
And there's also a bunch of devices which I think would be interesting to talk about. There is something called Pilot Translation Kit. Mm-hmm. Now, it's earbuds. It's earbuds which look like earbuds, which feel like earbuds, but get the best translations in Europe right in your ear with this pair of earphones. The devices consist of two earphones. Of course, we've got 2 ears, so 2 earphones. One earphone listens to someone speaking next to you while the other translates it into the ear.
Well, that's translation in real time. Thank you, technology.
The earphones work offline and can also be used to listen to music.
Wow.
I mean, that is technology. That is really, really technology. But then, you know what? These are paid apps. some are free. Some of them are free. Now, our Papago Translate is free. But Pilot Translation Kit, well, they're physical objects. So mm-hmm. I can understand how it comes for a price.
Obviously.
And it is on a pre-order of $199. And it starts shipping in May.
I don't think that's bad. $199 isn't bad for something as useful as that.
Yeah.
When you're spending so much traveling abroad, then why not make the best of it, right?
I agree. Well, coming from the technology guru in our channel, we must watch Tech It Out, which is a show on consumer technology at its best. What's new? What's coming up? What's what to look forward to? All of that in Tech It Out at these times.
So, Satya, we were talking about voices, and here is a story called We the Voice, which is about 3 women in the village of Sajoi in UP. In Varanasi, located a few kilometers away from Varanasi. So there are these 3 women who were the first 3 women to pass out of class 12th in this village. And these women are going around collecting kids, teaching them, educating them. And just because of their efforts, they've made schooling possible for 90% children in their village. They were the first to complete their education, and now they are, you know, repaying their debt of gratitude, and they're educating children further in the village.
Now, that's again in the DNA you're looking at?
Yes. It's the same page, like I said.
Oh, yes.
I couldn't take my eyes off of you.
That's beautiful. Lovely.
Beautiful.
That's lovely. So, okay, so since this is the end of our Between the Lines segment, let's now take you to the poll that we took. Now, we asked people if they considered skin tone to be a parameter in choosing their life partner. Mm-hmm. And this is what the results are. 57% say no, we do not choose our partners.
Yay.
Based on skin tone. How that's encouraging.
Yes.
27% say yes.
And 60% have mixed thoughts.
Well, 60%, come on people, let's take a stand. If we have to make our voice heard, we have
Absolutely.
To make our voice heard, and this is a very, very sensitive topic. But I'm very, very it's very flattering and it's very encouraging to know that 57% of the people said that skin tone is not a parameter in choosing their life
partner. I agree with all this 57% of them completely, and I'm really glad that you guys took this story so seriously and followed up so well on
it. Well, we take our guests on WION Breakfast very, very seriously, and we take our viewers very seriously. And on that note, we go into a very short break, but come right back because we have fitness and we have quick bites coming up on the other side. So come right back. Welcome back. You're with us on WION Breakfast. And now it's time for stretching out a little bit. So let's go to WION Stretch, where we bring you a yoga session with Zubin Athre, and he will take the Athre Yoga series further. That will help you, me, and you keep fit.
Buongiorno, this is Zubin from Athre Yoga Studio, and today I'm here with a set of asanas which is going to help you feel more stabilized and balanced. Now that we have done the balancing position, now this is the time to feel more stable and still in your core. So we'll be moving a little towards the strength part of the series, and which is where it gets slightly challenging. Go at your own pace, take what you easily can and do what you easily can. Standing right on top of your mat with your feet parallel to each other. Let yourself spread your toes open and wide so that you have a broader base to balance on. Grip the mat nice and easy, and slowly when you breathe out, you'll be letting yourself press your toes down on the mat in a way that you let yourself lift your heels up. Let there be a very gentle lift in your chin. Continue breathing in and out and leave your arms loose and supple for the moment. As slowly when you breathe out, you'll be sending both the arms up and over the head. Reach up with your arms as up as it can get, keeping them parallel to each other. Continue breathing in and out and notice how, with every release of the breath, you propel your body up towards the skies. And slowly when you breathe out, you'll be letting yourself place your heels down onto the mat very gently, keeping the arms over the head. Continue breathing in and out, standing tall, using all the muscles surrounding your spine. Now slowly when you breathe out, you'll be joining your hands together. You can lock your thumbs and reach up with your fingers as up as they can get, keeping the arms in touch with your ears. Continue breathing in and out. Now when you breathe out, you'll be letting yourself tilt your body down to the left hand side, bringing your body weight towards your right hip. Make sure that your chest and your tummy has to still face in front, and you're breathing in and out. Take a long deep breath in, and you'll be bringing yourself up and back using the strength of the obliques. Now from there, when you breathe out, you'll be letting yourself tilt your body down onto the other side. The idea here remains to stretch the torso. Continue breathing in and out. Inhalations are long, deep, and slow. Using the strength of the obliques, you'll be bringing yourself up and back again and standing tall with your arms up over the head. Lifting your chin up, start pulling the arms further back behind your ears. Pull them as back as they can get till they're off the side, they're behind your ears, and you still have the gentle lift in your chin. Get the arms up and parallel to each other. Show the palms up towards the skies and let yourself pull the arms further back, drawing a big circle as big as it can get. Continue breathing in and out. Keep the movement of the breath in total sync with the movement of the arms. Half the circle you'll be breathing in, half the circle you'll be breathing out. Notice how the way the blood rushes towards your hands as you lower the arms down, and as slowly when you breathe out, you're going to get the arms up in parallel to each other right in front. Bend your knees and let yourself sink down into the chair's position, noticing that the weight stays on your heels and your shoulders are away from the ears. Keep reaching out with your fingers as far as they can get. Lessen the arch you have in your lower back and keep your back flat as it can be. Hold that position, focusing more on the exhalations. Notice how with every release of the breath, your navel goes in towards the spine, and you'll be using the strength of your abdominal muscles to push your navel in close to the spine. Taking a long deep breath, you'll be sending both the arms up over the head, reaching up with your arms. Arms will be reaching up at the same time you're still sinking down with the tailbone. You're using all the muscles in your upper back. Muscles surrounding your spine and the thighs are nicely engaged and activated. You're still breathing in and out with more attention towards the exhalation. You're letting yourself pay extra attention towards the end of the exhalation, where your navel goes in towards your spine. And slowly when you breathe out, you'll be lowering the arms down and you'll be bringing yourself up. Let yourself relax. I hope you really enjoyed this set of asanas, where we could get all the time to focus on the balance and the strength. We prepared the core for the upcoming set of asanas, which will be helping you to feel more strengthened and grounded as you go further into the series. I'll see you on the mat next time.
Zubin Athri can stretch. In that stretched position, he can talk, and he can talk effortlessly, and he makes sense.
Yes, now, absolutely. What a treat to watch him, even though we are not such fitness freaks as Charu is.
I know, right? Oh my God, no fitness gyan, but I have to give it to Zubin Athri. He is just awesome.
Phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. And with Zubin, we are also keeping Charu's spirit alive here.
Totally. There you go. Charu, we miss you.
We miss you so much, Charu.
Zubin misses you. We all miss you. And like Charu always says, she gives me a chance to talk about food as soon as the fitness segment is over. So.
Yes. And which is also my favorite part on this show. So up next on Quick Bites, we will show you superfood being made by Chef Abhinav. Super omelette, actually.
Hey guys, welcome to Jamie's Italian. This is Chef Abhinav. I'll be teaching you superfood omelette, which is the recipe for the day. A little bit of boiled lentil. Use your hands, much better way of doing this. A little bit of black pepper. Add a little bit of olive oil to it. This is a superfood omelet.
You know, omelets, however you make it, you just can't seem to go wrong with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And if it's made as attractive as this, I mean, it looks nicer than the normal.
It looks lovely. There's spinach, there's feta cheese, there's avocado, there's quinoa. Oh my God,
this
I really want to have
this is a superfood omelette.
Absolutely.
This is a superfood omelette. Well, now, this is, you know, you and I have been talking about it for a while now. Let's go across to the Twitter world. Let's go across to the Twitter world to see what the Twitterati are talking about. And today they're talking about why I got dumped. I got dumped because is the hashtag. And Jaluna says, I got dumped because I have two left feet and she only, well, that got away before I could read it.
I got a tattoo of her face. I gave out raisins for Halloween.
That's why I got dumped? Oh, well, that's not
good
a nice reason.
Reason.
Come on. Well, apparently because eating is cheating, which is why I got dumped, says George.
What were you thinking, George?
Really? Come on.
I became more emotionally invested in Grey's Anatomy characters than my relationship. That's totally legit, though.
And that's what Jess... Oh, come on. Come on, Jess. That's really no reason to get dumped. Mikey says, I refuse to take One Direction out of the CD player. That's why I got dumped. Oh, well. Come
kids,
on.
I tell you, dinner gave him food poisoning. She poisoned her
friend. Frank says, I was too honest, that's why I got dumped. Now, you know what? If honesty is the reason why one gets dumped, then you know what? It's just better to get dumped. It's just better to get dumped. Come on.
I agree with you. Only this morning I was telling you about how you should speak the truth out loud, no matter how difficult is it. But if it's that difficult, don't speak the truth.
I know, right? Well, with that, we will unmic ourselves. We had a lovely day with Sejal Pandey, but then time to connect with us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. We're all over social media. We'd love to hear from you. And that's all we have for you. On WION Breakfast today, I'm Satyashree Gandham.
And I'm Sejal Pandey. You've been watching WION Breakfast. Join us tomorrow at the same time.
But we leave you with this video of an Ugandan policeman who has turned to rap and breakdancing, hoping to win over a skeptical public in a popular music video praising the virtues of the police service. Enjoy the video as we wrap up the show. Police, we are physical effect. Get me gonna walk on your own. Police, professional effect. You get the police of today's not like the past. Transform from colonial to professionals. To natural pathetic when they come up professionals. We are not national, but we are international.
Thank you.